Yay.
This meeting is being recorded.
Good morning, good morning. Hey, it's the Clay Terrace Bible Study. We're studying the Clay Terrace Bible, apparently. No, I'm just kidding. It's our innovated version, because we're all going to be reading out of a different version, and that's kind of the idea anyway, is to have a diversity of thought and perspective here, and really trying to get at, though, the all-important, what is God really saying through the pages of Scripture? We would advocate for sola scriptura, right? That's what's important. But we come at it from different filters, and it's hard to get out of our own way and see it some other way if we don't have somebody sharpen it. So that's the point here. Every Friday morning, 8 a.m. Eastern, join us. Details are at clayterrace.org. That's clayterrace.org. So this morning we're going to be in Isaiah 1, finishing it up. We're going to start in verse 21. But first, Chaplain Tony, would you pray for us?
Yes, let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this day, the day that you have made. You've called us all to rejoice and be glad in it. We're forever thankful, Father, for the opportunity you give us to serve you. We pray, Lord God, on today, Father, for those, Father, who can't be online with us. We pray that you help them with whatever they are going through. We pray safety for their travel on today. And we just pray, Father, that you be glorified through all that we do. We pray that our light will shine before men so that they'll see our work and give glory to you who are in heaven. We pray, Father, for our families. We pray also for all those who don't have a relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We pray, Father, that they could accept Christ into their life on today. We thank you, Lord God, once again for what you're doing in this nation. We pray, Father, and believing, Father, for change in all areas of life. So we pray, Lord, that you continue to be glorified, lifted up through your people for your kingdom and for your glory here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Well, Pastor Jim Wright, you want to start us off reading Isaiah 1? We'll start in verse 21.
Okay. The faithful town, what an adulteress she has become. She was once full of justice. Righteousness once dwelt in her, but now murderers. Your silver has become dross to be discarded. Your beer is diluted with water. Your rulers are rebels, friends of thieves. They all love graft and chase after bribes. They do not defend the rights of the fatherless, and the widow's case never comes before them.
Therefore, the Lord Almighty, the mighty one of Israel, declares, "Ah, I will vent my wrath on my foes and avenge myself on my enemies. I will turn my hand against you. I will truly purge away your dross and remove all your impurities.
I will restore your judges as at the first, and your counselors as at the beginning. Afterward, you shall be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city. Zion shall be redeemed with justice, and her penalties, her penitence with righteousness.
But rebels and sinners will both be broken, and those who forsake the Lord will perish. You will be ashamed because of the sacred oaks in which you have delighted. You will be disgraced because of the gardens you have chosen.
For you shall be like an oak whose leaf withers, and like a garden without water. And the strong shall become tender, and his work a spark. And both of them shall burn together with none to quench them. Amen, amen. Let's go back and unpack this and try to see, can we build upon what 26 is really pointing us toward? These are broken up in segments, and I think when you get to verses 21 to 23, that's a segment. And implied in this is the promise of redemption with justice. And he's speaking to these unjust leaders of Judah. And I think we need to underline the fact that the leaders here are under attack because of their unfaithfulness. Now, he speaks about the whole city becoming a harlot. Once was a faithful city, Jerusalem, known for their faithfulness to God. But now, because he's using the metaphor of this harlot, this spiritual adultery, because they have forsaken their marriage to the Lord and they're dealing with idolatry. It was a place that once was filled with justice, not completely, but a place that was known for justice and righteousness in Jerusalem. Now the city, filled with murderers, political corruption, rebellious princes, which would be leaders again, thieves and frauds. And he's making the analogy again that their silver now has become polluted because it has dross in it, and that their wine is being mixed with water. We talked about that last week, that wine merchants were known that when they went to large festivals and they didn't have enough stock of inventory of wine, they would dilute it. So that they could meet in a profit, even though that was watered down. We look at that in today in our churches and our pulpits, how we've watered down God's intention to please people. Okay. Now, again, he talks about they're not defending the orphans, the fatherless, and they are not lifting up the cause of the widow. Those who were true widows, that had been faithful to the Lord, faithful to their husbands, and had no other means of support than the church is supposed to provide that for them. So there's another accusation here again, against the contrast of the values that the prophet is talking about, and God wants them to keep peace against these murderers, have integrity in the land again, and mixing wine with water, they have diluted the word of God, and that needs to be rectified. So then when we look at the last section here, it goes 24 to 31, being offered here is a remedy, is a plan of redemption and justice. Now I'm gonna take the position that this is speaking toward the future and speaking toward the Redeemer that is to come, speaking toward the branch of David. And we'll look at that a little bit later here. Starts off here with the commandant of the Marine Corps, even though we don't have one right now,
Uh-oh, Andy, you're frozen up.
Yeah, I don't.
Hopefully we can get him back.
Hear him either.
Hopefully we'll get him back in a second.
Yeah.
You know what he's saying about the Commodore of the Marine Corps, right? They can't get an approval for any of the military guys through Congress these days because Congress is so polarized. Pretty soon we'll be operating with all interim leaders of our military. How would that be? As you may or may not know, interim leaders can't make big changes. All they can do is kind of run under past authorities. Sorry, Andy. Yeah, we can hear you now. Hey, we lost you at the comment about no Marine Corps Commodore at the moment.
Okay. Yeah, no head of the Marine Corps, the Marine Corps Commandant. And here we get the war name of God, the Mighty One of Israel, the Lord of Hosts, referring to the armies that are in heaven that are always by his side. The Mighty One of Israel, he is now coming to oppose these actions that are going on. And this should be really a wake-up call for them, because he says, I will rid myself of my adversaries. Okay, so his adversaries now are the leaders and the people of Judea that have set themselves as adversaries of the Lord because they're practicing idolatry, and the leaders are not teaching them exactly what the scriptures are saying. So they're acting like enemies. So this puts them on a path, a direct path for judgment from the spirit of judgment, which comes from God himself. Now he talks about taking away the draws. You know, he's saying that your silver has too much draws and that he's going to take away the alloy. Draws and alloy are impurities when it comes to gold and silver. So how do you drive out the draws and the alloy? You turn up the heat. So he says, I'm going to turn up the heat on you, that I will burn out all of those impurities. My goal is not to destroy, but my goal is to restore. And the only way to restore is to take out those impurities. If I want Jerusalem to become a faithful city again, a holy city, I've got to destroy their enemies and take out all of their impurities. This is the redemption that we're seeing that's coming to Zion with the redeemed justice of God himself. Now, God never redeems at the expense of his justice and righteousness. Everything has to come back in the line. He tells them how they should be ashamed of the fact that they're going up and worshiping in the oaks. This is where the Canaanites would worship, and there would be fertility gods and other things going on up there. He talks about the sacred trees, and he's just showing that the fact that they have totally departed from the faith, and that because of that, and this comparison is really interesting, he's saying now they're going to be like a garden that has no water, that we're going to be like wood that is ready to burn, and that our actions are going to be like a spark, and that's what's going to set the fire. But really, he's going to set the fire. And why is he going to set the fire? He's going to set the fire because of our idolatry. I want to you to go to go to Isaiah 4 and 3. Maybe we can start there. Isaiah 4 and 3, really pick it up at 2, okay? We're going to go Isaiah 4, 2 through 4. Isaiah 4, 2 through 4. In that day, the branch of the Lord shall be beautiful and glorious, and the fruit of the land shall be the pride and honor of the survivors of Israel. And he who is left in Zion, remains in Jerusalem, will be called holy. Everyone who has been recorded for life in Jerusalem. When the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion and cleansed the bloodstains of Jerusalem. Now remember, Isaiah said they had blood on their hands, right? Okay, cleanse the bloodstains of Jerusalem, for in its midst, by its spirit of judgment, and by, excuse me, the spirit of burning. So what we have to recognize here is, who is this branch that Isaiah is speaking about? Go to Jeremiah 23 and 5. Jeremiah 23 and 5. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. Skip down to Jeremiah 33 and 15. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch, notice branch is always capitalized, to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. Let's take a minute and go to Zechariah 3 and 8. Zechariah 3 and 8. Hear now, hear now, O Joshua, the high priest, you and your friends who sat before you, for they are men who are a sign. Behold, I will bring my servant, the branch. You're still in Zechariah, but go to chapter 6, verse 12. And say to him, thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, the man whose name is the branch, for he shall branch out from his place, and he shall build his temple. Now, when it comes to 26 of Isaiah 1:26, and it's talking about going back to the times, giving them counselors and going back to the times of when they were faithful. You know, I first thought maybe they're talking about Moses and Joshua or the time of David. But the most, the deeper you get into this, it seems like this is a description of the redemption that comes through the Church of Jesus Christ, and that it is Jesus who is this righteous branch that shall reign as king, and then all the impurities are gone, all the characteristics of the leaders, the bad leaders, have been totally taken away. They have been dealt with, and now because of this redeemer, kinsman redeemer that comes, that he will restore the nation, he will bring the new covenant to Israel. Again, Jesus Christ is the true Israel, so this is Israel and the church, everybody who believes in Christ Jesus, and that they will honor and be, and the land will be healed, and that the dross will be, and the alloy will be taken out of the silver, because Christ Jesus is gonna execute justice and righteousness. Look at Isaiah 9 and 7. Isaiah 9 and 7. And of the increase of his government, personal pronoun here is referring to the Redeemer to come, of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, it established, to establish it and to uphold its justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. And if you skip down to Isaiah 11 and 5, righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. We recognize that God called Abraham to be the channel of blessing for the whole world, and this is the purpose of Israel's life in the land. But everything is based on the messianic hope from this branch this righteous one that comes from the line of David, who will extend his rule over Gentiles and Jews, and thus finally bring the blessing of everyone knowing the true and living God. It will be this branch that brings this. So I think everything here points to Jesus. Go ahead, Holly.
Oh, I was, Jim said he had a question.
Yeah, oh. I had a question, Brother Andy, because I know when we went in Revelation, you were amillennial. So my understanding on the amillennial is when Christ comes back, that's it. There's a new heaven, a new earth immediately follows, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So how does this work? Because Jesus comes back, he's annihilated his enemies. So now I assume we're talking, actually Isaiah's talking about on the new heaven, a new earth, we're going to have righteous judgments and advisors. And why would you have to have that on the new heaven and new earth?
Well, I don't think it's a contrast to righteous versus unrighteous. It's righteous because God is righteous and he is holy, and now he's in control of all things. So I think it's a statement of fact from the understanding, in my limited understanding, that Christ is the one that restores. And that when he restores, then all these things come to pass by virtue of his authority and by virtue of his reign. And that's not to say that Christ doesn't reign now. He doesn't reign totally.
So Andy, is this only talking about the way far in the future into, as Jim said, the new heavens and new earth? Or is it saying and to use the Beale's term, inaugurated at his first coming?
Well, it was definitely proceeding. In John, but then is it progressive? I would agree, yes, it's progressive, but it's fulfillment in how it's being presented in the Isaiah doesn't happen until Christ reigns fully.
Wait a minute, say that again.
It's inaugurated with his first coming. It does not reach its fulfillment until his second coming. It's progressive. It's like our salvation. We are saved. We will be saved. Like progressive sanctification, we're growing in it or growing into it. But the fulfillment doesn't come until Christ comes.
Okay, but Isaiah, these words in Isaiah are speaking to that whole process?
Yes, I would say so. I mean, there, Isaiah is speaking, we call it in the future, but it's just part of the eternal story of what will happen. I mean, we think, okay, it's a long way off. You know, I thought being 65 was a long way off when I was 10, but it's a reality, and it has been progressive, and now I'm there. And we will see his glory in his fullness. I mean, we know it's not this time. I mean, we are just as corrupt as Israel was, if not more now. So we know it's not now. We know it wasn't then. So what other marker do we have but the future to come?
Oh, okay. So, well, first of all, did that, Jim, answer your question?
Yeah, obviously I'm looking at this at a premillennial perspective that Christ reigns on the earth for 1,000 years. And so if this is that Jesus comes back and then we're immediately in the new heaven and new earth, why would Jerusalem be called the righteous city or faithful city when all the cities presumably be faithful And why would you need judges restored as before when nobody's going to be sinning? And again, I to me, that just doesn't work very well. That's just my view. And I think verses 27 through 31 is speaking of Israel's repentance upon Christ's return. So there you go.
Well, with that last part, we can totally agree on that. Right. is speaking of Israel's repentance at the last day. But what we would disagree on is a 1,000-year reign that then is overturned by Satan. So Jesus has reigned and ruled for 1,000 years and proved that his authority and sovereignty is impotent because there is another fall that happens and that we rise up, Satan is able to rise up against him. That won't work.
Yeah, I would just say it wasn't Satan was allowed to. He was released from the pit. And I think it's proving that humanity, even when we have utopia on the earth, will still rebel if given the chance. It's kind of anticlimactic too, because once Satan is released, I think that's a key. It was done on purpose, and he leads the rebellion. It's immediately squashed, and then we go into the end. So to me, it's just to point to mankind that even with utopia on the earth, with Jesus reigning, humanity, if given the chance, many will still rebel against him. So that's my two cents.
Yeah. And we saw that in Genesis. We're already seeing that Adam and Eve were in utopia, but yet they rebelled. So I mean, we've already seen that movie.
Well,
which was so that man, even in the best situation, is simple. Go ahead,
well, if I could, well, I was just gonna say, if I could referee for a second.
Minister together. You know, I'm more.
Oh, I know that. No, you know, I meant it in the kindest way.
Yeah.
No, what I'm saying is, I think you would both agree that there is some level of progressive redemption that's going on via Christ in quote unquote the millennium, right? You only just disagree as to exactly what year that starts. Whereas Jim, we would say it starts with Christ coming. And Jim says, isn't going to happen progressively until you know, someday in the future, some date. And then it'll be progressive in which he'll rule. I assume, Jim, don't let me put words in your mouth, that you would believe in the millennium that Jesus is going to progressively redeem things. It won't immediately be utopia. Oh, you're on mute.
When you say progressively redeem, I think my view would be Matthew 25, after the return of Christ, who separates the sheep from the goats. The only people that initially enter the millennium are believers. Now, as far as the creation, it's going to be definitely probably in the process of mending. But the point is over those 1,000 years, those believers are going to have children. Those children are going to have children. And obviously, it's not all of them. They're going to be under the authority of Jesus, the King, but they're not going to like it. And when Satan is released, they're going to rebel. And God's going to say, okay, we're done. We've done everything, shown you every example of how it works, and you're not going to accept it. So that would be my view. And I think chapter two is a very clear, I'm kind of interested to see how we handle chapter two when we get there. But anyways, yeah, two different perspectives.
Okay. And Andy, just to divide it further, there's some of us that don't think there's going to be some ultimate something that Israel is going to somehow, and you know, I wouldn't even know how you define Israel at this point, but I can't say that I believe that ultimately there's going to be this turning of Israel back to the Lord. That's not the point of this text.
No, but as
I just
want
to make sure
Israel,
we all divided it as much as possible.
Right. I don't think it's ethnic Israel. I don't think everyone who's a Jew will convert. all of Israel will be saved out of Romans 11, speaks of all of those who have faith in Jesus Christ, not ethnic Israel, like everyone who was a descendant. I mean, we dealt with that in Galatians.
Okay. All right. Sorry for that rabbit trail.
Neil, if I understand, Neil, your position is the world's going to progressively get better until the church triumphs at the end.
With this caveat that it's pretty clear that Satan's going to have his time at some point, right? He's going to have his time of being pretty darn effective. But until then, yes, I believe absolutely the church is an overcoming church. I think we see that clearly in Jesus talks through John to the seven churches that, you know, there's this chronic command and elsewhere, chronic command to overcome, overcome, overcome. And I'm going to say, and it's a practical point, how would you, we see it in our, hopefully see it in our lives individually, this progressive sanctification. And as Christianity is spreading across the globe today, how could it do anything but, you know, become more and more redemptive? Now that said, with this caveat, like a dog that you, a barking dog that you corner, when you really get him into a corner, he's liable to become vicious. So that's kind of the way I see, the allowing of Satan to become extremely vicious at some point. The only mention there for me was, no, I don't see an ethnic turning at the very end. But I know I'm a minority view on that. So go ahead, Andy. You can pick it up however you want to pick up those pieces and get us through the end of Isaiah 1.
Well, you definitely have thrown those pieces all over the place. But
don't blame me. Blame Luther and Calvin and all those guys that started fracturing.
That's right. Blame those guys.
Yeah.
Go back to Augustine and start with him. Or you can go back to Origen and start with him.
Oh, my goodness. Well, let's just look at 30 and Isaiah 1, 30 through 31 as we get out of this. For we shall be like an oak whose leaf withers and like a garden without water. Is this not the contrast to what Isaiah is saying? Is this not a direct contrast to what God has used Jeremiah to say in Jeremiah 17:8? And I'm gonna go Jeremiah 17:8-9. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when the heat comes, for its leaves remain green, and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. So regardless of the resources, God is going to make us like a tree settled with, he was contrasting us to a shrub in the desert, that we're not going to be anything like that. But then 9 gives us the greatest metaphor ever. And when people tell me that, well, the Lord knows my heart, I always remind them of Jeremiah 17:9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? Talks about how torturous and uneven and desperately sick we are when we are full of our emotions. And that this position or this heart disease that we have from the beginning because of the introduction of sin into our life is really not curable unless we are taking the remedy for sin that comes through Christ Jesus. that he's the only cure for sin. Lastly, looking at, I think it's 31 here, and the strong shall become like tinder, and his works a spark, and both of them shall burn together, and with none to quench them. Here we see that self-salvation is self-destruction, that the only way that we can, again, the only remedy to sin and is Christ Jesus. The only redemption comes through salvation, turning away from those things that we have given our spiritual authority to here with these guys who have the same concern about spiritual adultery, and that their works in idolatry have made their lives, their bodies like tinder, and their work is a spark. And both of them shall burn together, and none will be there to quench them. Look at us, Isaiah 66 and 24. Isaiah 66 and 24, Isaiah is using the image of Israel as the city's dump site. You know, that's where the image of hell comes from, like in Matthew, that this place where they would take all the refuse, right? Dead bodies, dead animals, and where the fire never went out and the worm, maggots never died. Isaiah 66, 24, and they shall go out and look on the dead bodies of men who rebelled against me. For their worm shall not die, their fire shall not be quenched, and they shall be in abhorrence to all flesh. Now, I don't think anywhere in here there's any gloating, a gloating to be done, but that what we see here is that God, again, is true to his word, and that he's just and a justifier when it comes to these situations, and that we can trust him to bring justice every time. And that he's given us warning after warning after warning, sign after sign after sign, but we are just rebellious. And because of our rebellious nature, we find ourselves in a situation that is irreversible for us. And that's always dangerous for people who don't recognize exactly who their God is. So this is a terrifying picture of the end judgment. In fact, look at Mark 9:43-49. Really to 50, and then we'll close with that. Mark 9:43-50. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than with two hands to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. Of course, this is hyperbole. It is better for you to enter into life lame than with two feet to be thrown into hell. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes in hell, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. So one of the things that came that we need to have salt in ourselves. One of the charges in Isaiah 1 is that not only were the leaders unjust, but we were unjust to one another in the way that we dealt with one another. So again, this is showing us, giving us a preview of how we should love one another in such a way in the church that it attracts those outside of the camp of Christ Jesus and makes them jealous to want to participate in such a caring and loving community. And that's me.
Okay. So our infamous question then, how does it apply today in the world that we all live in? And we say in the Clay Terrace neighborhood, it's Friday at Clay Terrace. How does this apply? Thoughts? Holly?
That, you know, God is glorious. His judgment is glorious. He doesn't forget, you know, any unrighteousness. He doesn't overlook anything that is evil or bad. He doesn't forget it. But we forget how glorious God is. We not only some, you've got the righteous camp is in Psalm 1, you got the righteous camp and the wicked camp, but even the righteous camp can forget. They can forget how glorious God is. They can forget how his judgment is perfect. And he's the only righteous one. Not, you know, we lift ourselves up and think we are the good or we know or we this, but it's not we, it's him who's the glorious one who is all in all. And we forget that, I think. And so I think Isaiah to me reminds me how glorious is and how perfect his judgment is. And he's not going to forget. He's going to make it right. It's like, okay, you always say, well, how can I make this right? Well, God is the one who makes it right through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave such love. There was no love that he gave. We weren't righteous people. He gave his life for sinners. Yeah. That expresses that perfectness and his gloriousness. Yeah. Yep.
Never has there been such a Presbyterian there, Neil. I want you to see that. Never has there been such a Presbyterian.
Hey, what can we say? That's what I'm you get from attending a Presbyterian church all these years.
I wish that was strong.
Yeah. You know, as we were reading through it, and we talked numerous times about the leaves withering and the water and so forth. It is Psalm 1, right? Am I thinking right? You know, that he's so blessed, this man who's plants a tree by the water and so forth. And yeah. Again, that a similar vision of in Revelation 20. Two at the very end, right?
Right.
These metaphors are just used over and over and over. Seems like and as you pointed out, Andy, the metaphors about, you know, hell being where the worm doesn't die that eats you and so forth. It's kind of hard to take Isaiah and go, oh, it only applies to, you know, this little period of time or this little period of time or this little period of time. And even if it does, okay, great. It's just really hard for it to be clear enough to apply it and go, oh, well, that's not today. So we don't have to worry about what Isaiah said. You know what I'm saying? That is, it seems to me like it's a continuous challenge that God puts in front of us, and that yes, ultimately the redemption, as I see it anyway, the exiles were able to go back to Jerusalem physically, but as far as I know, they never set up judges like they were at first, or counselor, wise counselors as they were at first. I just don't see this applying in physical national Israel sense of the term of the Old Testament term. But I do see it applying to all faithful believers for all time, the challenge that's in front of us to be faithful, and that he is going to reward that, because he's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him, according to Hebrews.
Amen. Amen.
With that, let's see, it's 9 o'clock. Holly, you got any other last words, and then pray us out?
Okay, I don't have any other last words. Are we
all right? Okay.
Okay. Father in heaven, you are all in all. Your love pervades all. Let us receive your love and turn from wickedness in all that we do. Let us bring others into the kingdom, your glorious kingdom that never fails, that is perfect, Lord. And we just want to express our love and thanks for the Bible. And Lord, just lead us by your Spirit into all truth through Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
I've got a rogue.